Hey boys, John Kerry, 1963 Jag, coming at you with a little Jaguar specific internal detail video today. I'm going to document some variations on the E-Type or Jag XK engine oil filter housing assembly. And what you see here in front of you is two of them that are fundamentally the same, although they seem to be from slightly different vintages, meaning that the casting numbers on the outside of the housings and the part number that's cast inside, which I'm not sure you can read there, but it says 114753, and over here there's a number 179. Those numbers are identical on these two housings. However, when I took them apart, what I found was that the bypass valve assembly, which is a sort of interesting little spring-mounted ball bearing device in this one, is a little different. And here you can see the difference in the way those were made. They're both still ball bearings with a spring inside, but you can see the window in this one has been sort of milled off square, and this one's been drilled out. So I'm not quite sure if that makes any difference. That my guess is this is the original one from my E-Type 3.8 liter engine, which would be a 1963 vintage. This one is from another vintage car, and I don't know what it is because I didn't take it apart. So I don't really know which one that is. And then there is this one, which is very different. Although it fits, according to everybody, on the same bolt pattern mounting to the block, and you can see here with the oldest of the three and the newest of the three set side by side, the bolt patterns are indeed identical. However, the oil filter sort of overflow or bypass sump connection here is in largely the same location. This one would go here, so you can see that they kind of position themselves very similarly. But this has this whole little bypass spring assembly deal here, which this one does not. This one has a bypass mounted down in the inside of the housing, which you can see when you look in from the front or the filter element side right there. And that is kind of a spring mounted little guy that if I press down on it, you'll see it flexes and it does actually release. So there's got to be some kind of a... This is a much more sort of, let's say, primitive version of that, which was put into the later filter housing. Interestingly, this filter housing has two places for two, an O-ring out here and another one out here. Depending on what kind of car it was fixed to, it either had the big, wide, short, stubby housing with a filter element, or it had the long, narrow filter housing that fit here. So what I cannot find, at least not so far, is a part number that's been cast into this assembly. It has made in England here on the side of the flange. It has Tecalmet, or whatever their name was, Tecalmet, the name of the company that made them, T-E-C-A-L-M-A-L-E-M-I-T, Tecalmet. But as do these others, they have that same branding on them. Here you can see the Tecalmet name, and over here you can see made in England. Sorry, no, this one says filter. Oh gosh, here, let's see if we can get that in a magnifying glass. It says too much reflection. The camera's not going to be able to resolve that, but I can blow it up, and it says part number or filter number FA 2746. So it says filter number FA2746 on the outside, and then on the inside it has the cast part number, which is the Jaguar part number that's in their catalog, and the 179, which I don't know what that means, but both of these are identical. Let's see if this one resolves any better for you guys. It's a little less shiny because I didn't in fact wire brush this one yet. Yeah, it's not going to show up. The FA2746. So filter element, I guess, or something like that would be the number that you'd go looking for. So, so just some documentation so everybody knows what this stuff looks like. Here's a little bypass spring or bypass assembly here, a lower element that looks brand new, that was probably a replacement part purchased by someone. Here's another one that I took out of one of the filter housings that had two aluminum washers on it, presumably to increase spring tension, maybe to increase the bypass pressure. I don't know. And it also is interesting to point out that this one's got a base plate, which fundamentally, you know, amounts to adding a little thickness washer, whatever, spring tension. It's much thicker than the other two that I think are the original parts right here. So the one with the two washers on it sort of was the most, let's say, the most tension. This would be the second, and that would be the third most tension. And then this little veined assembly sits at the top of the spring like that and goes up in to the housing. Up down in there, you can see that there's a little brass insert. Maybe you can't. Oh, yeah, there you go. You see it sticking up a little proud? So there's a little insert in the casting, sort of a milled. Maybe it's not brass, it's steel. And that little vane assembly goes all the way up in there on the end of the spring, typically. So I guess I can't really do it unless I use a spring to kind of act as a holder. There you go. You can see it's going to slide up in there. So that seats up in that chamber. And then this base piece, let's use the new one just for example, goes in the bottom of the spring like that. And then your overflow hose adapter basically just captures this little part, and then you squeeze it, screw it up in there. So that's how that little dealie works. I know at least once I had an email or a posting on Jag Lovers that asked about these little baffle plates that are inside the filter assemblies, and I've taken them both off because, well, partly because I want to fit a modern filter adapter assembly to one of the three of these base plates that I'm going to use on my car. And it goes on like that, and then it uses a bolt assembly like so to attach this spin-on filter housing adapter. So now I can just use a modern spin-on style filter, which I'm quite happy about because the original equipment on this car was a paper cartridge inside of a three-piece, you know, sort of canister housing with rubber washers at the top to stop it from leaking and an O-ring at the bottom. So there you have it, part number 114753, two of those, and part number I don't know, not known, not printed on it, not cast into it at least. So there could have been a tag on it at one time when it was new equipment. This one's definitely a more modern version of the assembly, but I'm not inclined to use it because it's got that big extra ring around it that I don't need, because my assembly, you can see here, my filter adapter assembly would actually fit on there. Oops, no, I need a longer bolt though, because the threaded portion of this one, which you can see starts right here at the top, that one doesn't thread in until way down in there. So I'm not quite sure if indeed this is the proper part for this base. Probably not. But it does fit on there, but I wouldn't use it. Okay. So anyway, though, I got distracted. The base plate, both have these little splash guards, I guess they call them. So that one goes there. And on the older versions, meaning for the 3.8 liter or original Series 1 4.2 liter engines, you see the center diameter is bigger. So these two plates are not the same. See here? Quite a bit bigger, or vice versa. If I put that one on here, you can see that one will not even come close to fitting over the opening. You could make it work if you, you know, wanted to file it out. So I posted some dimensions once for the guys on the forum, and I'm going to do another version of that, and I'll take some. The external diameter is exactly the same, but the internal diameter is smaller on the more modern part. That's the only difference I can ascertain. They both appear to look good, but these are extra parts now that I'm going to put that spin-on adapter. So that's what I've been fiddling around with, and I went up to my, you can see here, I took my intake manifolds off, and my carburetor showed up the other day, which I took a little picture of, but I didn't take a video, so there's the intake manifolds down in the plastic tub, and then I have the carburetors over here. So I'm going to show you guys how nice these turned out. absolutely beautiful. The guy did great, great work. So you can see how they came packaged in a beautiful little plastic bag, and everything was yummy and lovely. And let me put you down for a second. Hey guys, how's everybody doing? I'm aware that everybody's noticed that there's a dearth of videos from literally everybody on the group, and I think it's a consequence of it's getting a little colder, and it's a little more difficult to get out in the shop some days. And then I was traveling, and I was busy with a million things going on at work, so I haven't been able to get out here much, but it's... I was out here this weekend. I spent all day yesterday, which was Sunday, up at my buddy's house, who has this beautiful shop of machine tools, and he's making me an adapter, pair of adapter plates to put the all aluminum radiator into the car, and those plates are going to be milled out of, you know, blocks of aluminum about that thick and about that long, you know, kind of gouging out to let them set down into the flanges that are on the radiator itself, and then we won't get any bimetal corrosion, because he did that mod to his car some years ago. This is Ray Livingston, and he posted his findings on the JCNA, Jaguar National Car Club or something of America, JCNA.com it is, and so it's an aluminum radiator mod that's a really sweet deal, because the aluminum radiators for the Jags are gazillion dollars, you know, $700-800 plus, or sometimes if you want the one that's fabricated to look like an original equipment Series 1 E-Type radiator, it's $1,800 or something. And so we can buy one for $200 from, you know, that fits into a Chevy, I think. It's a 19-inch by 21-inch cross-flow radiator, and fits perfectly. So anyway, he used metal flanges on his, and it's starting to rust, so he said he wanted to make them out of all aluminum. So that's what we're doing. He's making two sets, one for me and one for him. So hey, check out my carburetors. So this is a carburetor model number HD8, and the 8 stands for 8 1/4 inches above 1 inch, I think, or something crazy. SU originally manufactured these, so the SU carburetor company came up with that configuration of numbering the carburetors. So it's got some nice, you know, patina to it. I mean, these are brand new, the throttle shafts. It looks like the throttle plates are replaced. Either that or he polished them, I don't know which. New screws that go in there. New seals and bushings on either side. This choke linkage down here is all nice and smooth and works beautiful. Everything's replated. Everything's been repolished and refinished to make it look and operate as good as new. So I'm just couldn't be happier with how these turned out. I mean, they just absolutely turned out perfect. So happy, happy camper. Got a little oil leaking out of there. I wonder if he filled these dampers with oil and now I'm letting them spill out. That's probably what's going on. I probably need to keep these upright somehow. Start to thinking about that. Yeah, I'm really pleased. I mean, you can read all the little markings and everything on there. And there's a vacuum advance port for the carburetor, or for the distributor. It's even labeled IGN for ignition. Very, very cool. And this one, I think, was labeled... This one's got a label on it, right? F for front. So, oh, man. Yeah, very, very happy. So I got three of those that are going to go on the car side by side. So it just looks like a gem inside there, alongside the beautiful polished, you know, cam covers. And I haven't done much else to the car since I last made a video. I did this high torque small lightweight starter motor, and I had to take it back out again to put a little jumper cable in between the solenoid connection and the battery connection, because on my car the solenoid is actually remotely located over here, and my wiring harness as original equipment, wouldn't allow for the solenoid wiring, the switch wiring, to go all the way over there. So I'm going to use the solenoid to switch the battery power, and then I'll just jumper the battery power to the solenoid. So it'll work just like original. I don't have to rewire anything. So that's kind of cool. I had my clutch slave cylinder out in order to get that bracket mounting in down there. And you can see the bracket that holds the flex line goes on to this cylinder block right down there. And I couldn't figure out exactly where that went. And I did a bunch of research on the internet and was poking around. And I finally was able to find some information about where that particular little bracket mounted. And what I'm struggling with now is I can't get a wrench in there on the slave cylinder because it's so tight. You can see there's just no room between the firewall or the tunnel assembly and the motor transmission area back there. So I got some advice from a friend who said just take the slave cylinder out again, which is a little easier to do, to tighten up the brake line or the hydraulic line. Looks like a brake line. It's a hydraulic clutch fluid line. Tighten that all the way down, then put the slave cylinder back in place, and then reconnect at the flex connector, and that is probably what I'm going to have to do. So I'll be working on that. Other than that, not too much else going on. You know, I want to get the... I actually want to light up the motor before Christmas, so I'm standby, because it's not going to be too much longer before I can put some fire in the belly of Bettie. Have had... not much weather reporting. It's been okay, you know, not real cold, not real warm here. We get away with murder here in California because it never gets that cold. You can see I have a little jacket on, but it's not like I really need the jacket. It's just, you know, kind of cold. I just noticed somebody left this door standing wide open, so I'm coming to close it. I'll edit that out. Yeah, it's been kind of cloudy and overcast today. You can see there the sun setting off in the west at the moment. It's pretty much down, so it's going to start getting colder and probably darker in a few minutes. And I'm going to wrap up out here. I don't have a whole lot more to do. I just wanted to get these oil filter housings organized so I knew what I was dealing with. And I don't think the adapter plate fits quite right on the 3.8 and series 1 4.2 assemblies. It fits real good on this one, but I think what happened was the diameter, you see that little step in the turning of the center diameter is intended to let it clear over the second portion of this central assembly. You can see it has a little step in it, but the step isn't cut deep enough. So when I put that on there, you can see it bottoms out pretty early. Probably too early to really bite into the O-ring and make a good seal, because that O-ring channel is so deep and this isn't very deep here at all. So I think it needs some more work before I'm going to trust it. Either that or I'm going to buy another one. So anyhow, that's it. I'm going to say goodbye and wish everybody a great day. It was good to see Greg making a video and taking a last drive in the Ghia. Man, I can't wait. I don't care if it's cold out. I'm going to get this thing driving. I'm going to take it out and drive it. I won't go out in the rain, but I will go out if it's cold. I have a roof anyway. And I can't wait. And yeah, I'm watching the Model A with the heavy Chevy. And gosh, I haven't heard anything from Hanson 265 Chevy or... from Bill Stone Furball. Bridge Chef truck, I watched his little video the other day about getting the truck organized, and that looked nice. Ron's not doing anything. He put up a video just saying, wrecking yard, not much going on. Darren's done a couple videos. That was good. Thanks for that. So I'm watching. You know, I've subscribed to a bunch of new people. I'm getting the Google thing figured out. I made a video a little while ago saying I don't get it, but I was a Google member, so Google Plus, I mean, so when I linked my two accounts together, then all of a sudden I could start making comments again, and they started showing up again. And interestingly, just the other day I got a little pop-up when I went to somebody's video to watch. No, it was on my subscription page. Popped up and said, your comments are now going to show up in both your Google Plus and in your, as you used to see them in Yahoo or in YouTube. So I don't know. Maybe they got the message that everybody was bummed out and upset that it wasn't working so good, or at least it wasn't working easily for a lot of people, and then they made some changes. I don't know. Anyhow, I'm getting it figured out. So I've added everybody that I was subscribed to that I can find. I'm still missing a few people, I think, but I think eventually we're all going to get linked back together again as adding people to our Google Plus circle, which then brings them into your comments section or your notification section, I think it is. Okay, so I'll talk to you later. Have a good one. And, be safe. Have a great Thanksgiving. And enjoy your cars. Bye.